Thank you. that some people are colorblind and experience skin tone in different shades of vision, while others are partially colorblind and cannot perceive certain gradations of color. The image of the world that their eyes provide is different from that of a so-called normal person. The same applies to the other senses, too, more or less. This is already enough to demonstrate that even a simple sensation belongs to the private inner world. With my bodily senses, I can perceive the same red table that someone else perceives, but I cannot perceive that person's sensation of red. Therefore, the essential nature of the human being 29. We must describe this sensation as belonging to the soul. Once we are quite clear about this, we will stop looking at inner experiences as mere brain processes or something of that sort. Feeling follows closely on sensation, with one sensation arousing pleasure in us and another displeasure. These are the stirrings of our inner soul life. We each create an inner world of feelings in addition to the world that works in on us from outside. Then there is a third factor, our will, through which we work back upon the outside world, leaving the imprint of our own inner being on it. In will activity, the soul flows outward, in a sense. The fact that our actions bear the stamp of our inner life distinguishes them from natural events taking place in the outer world. In this way the soul sets itself up as something personal and private in contrast to the world outside. It receives stimuli from the outer world, but constructs an inner private world in accordance with them. Bodily existence becomes the basis for soul existence. 3. The spirit nature of the human being. The soul element in a human being is not determined exclusively by the body. We do not wander aimlessly and without direction from one sense impression to another, nor do we respond to every random stimulus that acts on us from outside or through our bodily processes. Instead, we think about our sensations and our actions. By thinking about our sensations, we come to an understanding of 14. 30 Theosophy. Things, by thinking about our actions, we create a rational coherence in our lives. And we know that we are only worthily fulfilling our tasks as human beings when we let ourselves be guided by the right thoughts, both in knowing and in acting. Therefore, the human soul faces a dual necessity. Out of natural necessity, it is governed by the laws of the body, but because it freely recognizes their necessity, it also allows itself to be governed by the laws that lead to correct thinking. Nature subjects us to the laws of metabolism, but as human beings we subject ourselves to the laws of thought. Through this process, we make ourselves members of a higher order than the one we belong to through the body. This is the spiritual order. Soul is different from spirit, as different as it is from the body. As long as we simply speak of the particles of carbon, hydrogen, oxygen and nitrogen moving around in our body, we do not have the soul in view. The life of the soul begins only at the point where sensation arises within such movement, where we taste something sweet or feel pleasure. In the same way, we do not have the spirit in view as long as we consider only the inner experiences that pass through us when we give ourselves completely to the outer world and to the life of the body. Rather, this soul existence is the basis for the spirit too, just as bodily existence is the basis for soul existence. The natural scientist biologist deals with the body, the soul scientist psychologist with the soul, and the spiritual scientist with the spirit. Anyone I'm trying to understand the essential nature of the human being by means of thinking is first required to come. The essential nature of the human being 31. Through self-reflection, to a clear understanding of the difference between body, soul and spirit. I.e., body, soul, and spirit. The only valid way for us to shed light on ourselves as human beings is by clearly grasping the significance of thinking within our overall being. The bodily instrument of thinking is the brain. We can see colors only by means of a well-formed eye. Similarly, only an appropriately constructed brain can serve the purpose of thinking. The whole human body is built up in such a way that the brain, the organ of the spirit, is its crowning glory. We can understand the structure of the human brain only when we look at it in relationship to its function, which is to serve as the bodily basis for the thinking spirit.